Iniziamo. Test, test, test. Livello iniziale.
Se vuoi iniziare inizio. Intanto io vado a vedere.
C'è qualcuno di là? Allora. Okay, so good morning everyone, and thank you very much for coming to the 11th edition of EuroSciPy. So I will be very quick in this introduction. Of course, most important announcements first, Wi-Fi connection. It's EuroSciPy 2018, and the password is very secure. Is this one? So exclamation mark, EuroSciPy 2018, exclamation marks. Okay. Actually, it's written basically everywhere, so you can see it. Okay. I wanted to start with a little bit of history of these events. I really like these events. It started back in the days of 2008 in Leipzig, in Germany, and stands there. And sorry for my pronunciation. And stand there in for 2 years. Actually, the location of conference changes every 2 years. It moved then to Paris, then to Brussels, Cambridge, back to Germany last 2 years, and for the first time now in Italy, here in Trento, thanks to you. And so this is the time to give some thanks, especially to the organization, Fondazione Bruno Kessler, and Associazione Python Italia, Python Italia Association, in particular to Annalisa Armani, Fondazione Kessler, great support, and Matteo Benci. And last but not least, to the Scuola di Medicina and Chirurgia, which is the venue which is hosting us. Of course, I would like to thank all the chairs in this conference. Ernesto Arbitrio, who's actually co-chairing with me the conference. Alexander Endorf, the program co-chair, and Emma Guyard for the tutorial chairs. And also, thank you. I know you can imagine how much difficult it is organizing such a conference, so this is well deserved. Others, organizers and volunteers, just put down some names. I hope I didn't forget nobody. Alessia Marcolini, Johnny De Gasperis, Mike Müller, who's one of the first organizers of EuroSciPy, so thank you very much. Michaela Müller, his daughter, Pierre Debuil, Sepi De Alassi, actually they couldn't make it to come to the conference, but they did a great job during reading all emails, collecting information, organizing. And the guys in blue are volunteering during the conference, so another big applause to them because they're giving a lot of... And we hope to have more in the next years. A special mention to Mena. Actually, she is the one who designed the t-shirt, the badges, and the logo, so thank you very much. And finally, of course, thanks to speakers. This year, we've been able to have 3 tutorial tracks, 2 tracks for the main conference, and 13 posters presented. Actually, today we're going to have posters presented. In the main corridor, and sponsors, Enthought, Manning, Wood Phoenix, and Boston Consulting Group. We also had a special mention for the Python Software Foundation and EuroPython Society, who grant us €5,000 for financial aid, so to support people who cannot afford the travel cost and the cost to participate to the conference. But of course, finally, the last thank goes to you, to all attendees. This morning I checked, we actually sold 398 tickets for this conference, considering tutorial tickets and main conference tickets. To be precise, we got 74 conference tickets sold, only conference, 44 tickets only for tutorials, and 140 tickets for both. And something I want to mention is that in these 2 days during the tutorials, I came across people wanted to buy tickets to the main conference to keep on staying with us in these days. So I think it's a great thing to mention. I would like to conclude with an announcement. So I heard you like an announcement, so I'm going to announce an announcement. We set up a Telegram group this year. It is an experimental, but I think it's sort of working. So this is the URL. It's a public group. It's meant to, for participants. We are in, of course, but and it's meant to share information, to socialize with you, and we're going to post a notification there and changes, last time changes or announcements or stuff like that. So if you can, please join this group. Moreover, we're going to have sprints on Saturday. Also on the whiteboard on the other side, we're going to have sign up for sprints. We're going to set up the last room we have for the sprints in these days. Another very interesting mention, one of our sponsors, Manning, actually offered us a discount code for all attendees, for all USAPI attendees. So I will share this this code again on the Telegram group. But actually, if you can take it, you have 40% off for all the attendees and on all ebooks offered by Manning. So thank you very much for them. And finally, we're going to do a raffle tomorrow, just after the first coffee break on Friday. Manning also offered 5 coupon code to get this book, Data Science at Scale with Python and Dask, completely for free. Okay, so we're going to raffle these 5 tickets, considering tomorrow, right before the first coffee break. So this concludes my introduction. I would like to give the stand to Felix in first keynote for EuroSciPy and how to drive business decision with artificial intelligence. So enjoy the conference. Hope you have a great time here and welcome to EuroSciPy.
Great.
Yes. Oh, here is the light pointer.
Can we wait? That means we are just fixing some issues for in how do you fix?
So good morning. I think we are waiting for 2 minutes because they are fixing something. Everybody got a seat? I think so. other room?
Yeah, and do a sound check for the other room.
Sure.
We are projecting the presentation on the other room for all the 12 people.
Mm-hmm.
We need to check sound.
Ah, that's good, so everybody got a place.
The audio is now reproduced here, so you just okay. Allow people that are
yeah,
so. To come through.
Yeah.
I think we can sound.
So, and maybe if you have to stand. Or
yeah.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so I think we start. So the audio in the other room is not working, unfortunately. So that means all of you have to stay in here. So good. For the next about 45 minutes or so, I have the pleasure to tell you a bit about how you could use AI, or rather machine learning, to do business decisions. So that means decisions with the help of machine learning. And if I say machine learning in this conference, of course, this means powered by the scientific Python stack. However, I will concentrate more on the algorithmic and conceptual side of things here. So that means here and there I might mention a package we use, but in principle I will rather talk about the methods we use for this. So maybe a few interpretations in the beginning. So AI. Larger than pure machine learning, but here I will, when I talk about AI, I mean machine learning. When I say machine learning, I mean statistical learning. So that means more or less everything which you do in machine learning nowadays is statistical learning, but there are a lot of fields which use it, and I will use it rather from the statistical corner. So, and for the things to come, so for all the examples, a basic concept which is good to understand right from the beginning is the difference between correlation and causality. So usually when you do a prediction model with machine learning, you are using correlations. So that means it's a hot day and maybe somebody buys more stuff or something like this. And if you think about to influence something, so for example, by setting a price to increase the demand or something, then this is a causal effect. So that means these are two different things. The models are different, and you will see some examples in the next minutes how this works. So maybe I wait for half a minute or something until the... You sure?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Good. Then, okay, this is anyway introductory again. So so when to use such machine learning methods. So usually in nature there are things which you just cannot predict. So for example, lottery, because it's purely random. So that means deterministic chaos or something like this. So in principle you could calculate it, but in reality you cannot, because there are just too many degrees of freedom. So usually with something like this, there's no need in machine learning because you can do nothing. So the stock market is something which is more or less here or something. And the examples I will tell about where we use predictive analytics or machine learning. So this is, for example, predicting the demand in a supermarket chain or something like this. So this is something which has uncertainty. So it's a random variable in the end which you want to predict. It's not a number like a cat picture, yes or no. It's a bit. It's actually a number with some uncertainty on top of it, but you can predict it. And usually if you have something like this, this is a good case. So it's difficult to do it just by a human, because you are dealing with uncertainty and you are maybe dealing with a lot of influencing factors, but it is possible by machine learning. And something like this, which you can calculate, you usually don't need machine learning for. So that means you rather have to find the sweet spot in business where you can use this stuff. And as it turns out, the sweet spot is quite large. So that means you can do a lot of things with machine learning nowadays. Okay, so now the title said business decisions. My example here comes from retail because this is where I have the two use cases which I will describe later on. And retail is actually quite a nice industry for machine learning usage because there you have the companies have the pressure that they have to use it. So if you think for other industries, this is not yet the case. So they just don't have to do it because they still earn a lot of money with their old style methods. But in retail, this is a different thing. So there you have quite fine margins. You have quite some pressure from competitors like Amazon and stuff. And you have the need for automation because you have to make a lot of decisions every day. So if you think of setting a price for all products or something like this, so that means this is something which humans just cannot do, or you have to have a lot of people doing it. And the use cases I will come to here is grocery store replenishment. So what does this mean? So in a supermarket, you have to have all the products in place every day. So that means if you think of apples or bananas, which are just only good for, so Patrick will come to bananas this afternoon as well, which are only good for a few days. So that means you have on the one side, you have to throw them away after some time. So that means you have waste. So you cannot just put a lot of them into your store and wait until everything is sold. And the other side, you don't want to have too much of them. So that means, and you don't want to have too less of them because of course, you want to sell the stuff. So that means you have the two different sides, and your demand, you have to fit to demand rather good. So, and if you have this prediction for your demand, so how much you will sell in the next days, for example, you know, with some calculation and optimization afterwards, how much you have to order. And this is meant with replenishment, so that you just fulfill the need of the people and just order the right amount. Pricing, okay, this is clear. And customer targeting, this is my second example, which I will go over at the end, because this is quite interesting, because this is actually a customized view. So this one, and also pricing, so they rely on products, stores, days, for example, as your finest level, and targeting is on customer level. So that means, for example, you give an advertisement or maybe a coupon to somebody, and then you hope that this person will buy more or something like this. So, and these two, as you are influencing something, so setting the price or doing an advertisement or sending a coupon, so this is then a causal model because you are actually influencing the outcome in the end, which you want to predict. So this is a bit more subtle than this one. So in the end, it is also kind of a causal model, but in reality, you can just use it with usual predictability, and then afterwards, operations research like optimization. So this is, I will first go over this in some detail, and then in the end, we will look a bit at causality. So yeah, so store replenishment. Already said a bit what it means. So, and the demand, so that means how much you need for a specific product in a specific location for tomorrow, this depends on a lot of different things. So a human can do it, and in not too long ago, there was, for each and every store of a supermarket chain, there was somebody in place who just said, okay, tomorrow I think maybe that much will be sold, and that means I order that much. And this was usually kind of gut feeling which they used. So this might be not too bad for some cases, but if you think of all these influencing factors, so the easiest thing would be, for example, day of the week. So on weekends, there's more sold than during the week or something like this. But there are a lot of other things going on, promotions, cannibalization, what might be another product which is similar is in promotion, and that means my demand for my product goes down or something like this, or availability, seasonality, weather, whatever. So there are a large number of influencing factors, and a human usually cannot take it into account everything. So that means your prediction will just be not good. So we are actually dealing with superhuman performance here in machine learning in this case. And it's not only this one. So what is even worse is that you also have a lot of decisions and predictions to make. So you have items, you usually have a few thousands in a store. So it depends if you are something like a discounter who only has 1,000 or 2,000, or if you talk about a supermarket which more or less has everything, then you talk about 20,000 to 100,000 items or something. And you have usually a number of stores from hundreds to thousands, again, depending on this. And you want to have your predictions at least daily. Some of them, if they can order during a day, they also might want to have it hourly or a few times a day or something like this. So that means you have a large number of decisions to make. And all these decisions you cannot make with precision as human. So that means you have some need for automation, actually. And so as I said, so the first step, the machine learning step, this is the demand forecasting. And now I will tell you a bit how we do this demand forecasting, because it's a quite interesting problem, actually. And then afterwards, we will talk a bit about how the decision is made on top of this. So so this is pretty easy. Everybody of you probably knows it. So this is the scikit-learn style of doing machine learning. So you have kind of an input vector where you have different features and different samples. So that means sometimes the price is 4 euros, sometimes it's 8 euros, different product and everything. And you want to learn it in a multivariate fashion. So that means you do a fit and store everything in expertise. So here the target, so we are talking about supervised learning here, and it's a regression problem because demand, or if you think of demand as sales, is a real number. So actually not a real number, but it's usually something like 0, 1, 2, an integer number actually. So and in the end, you want to capture the learnings on the target demand on the item store day combination, for example. So this is machine learning as you know it. So and then afterwards, you want to predict something out of it. So that means you have now a new data set. And here it usually means you're learning from the past. So let's say for the last few years, you have the sales pattern and all the input features of your stores and your items. And then you use it to predict to the future. So this can be new items, it can be new stores. So this is what machine learning does if you have kind of a generalized model. So that means you have no overfitting and you can use it on new features. And this is, in this case, it would be just the features we learned, and you have now new samples. And you use the expertise and you predict something. So this is what you would usually do. And something which is important, we will come later on to make a decision on top of it, is that you have a kind of a probabilistic output. So that means, in this case, a probability density function. Because if you only would have a number, you can only do a simple calculation on top. If you have a distribution, you can later on do an optimization by means of costs, so by means of a cost function. But we will come to details there. Yeah. So the question is on which level we do it, if we do it on product level or on product group level or on store level. So actually the predictions in the end, so they are on the finest level. So that means product location day, for example, or product location hour. So that means you really do it on the finest level in the model itself. All kind of different hierarchy levels are used. So this I will show you later. But in the end, it's important that the prediction is on the finest level, because what you want to do is you want to optimize each and every single decision by means of a cost function. If you would just have something like a distribution for a group of products, you could not optimize for each and every product, but you would only optimize for the group. So this is usually not what you want. Yeah, so just keep asking questions if you have something. Yeah. Yeah, so I will come to that on the next slide, actually. So the question was, does demand mean that you have sales, or is your target sales, or is your target demand? And actually, the target has to be demand, because in the end, you what you want to optimize is your order decision. And to know the order decision, you want to know the demand and not know the sales, because the sales is can be influenced by other things. So the first thing would be out of stock. So that means if you have an out of stock situation, so that, for example, means you have for some item, you have in the beginning of the day, you have 10 items in the store. And maybe at 2 o'clock or something, the 10 items are gone. And there are coming people who want to buy more. So that means you have an out of stock situation in the sense that your demand was actually higher than the sales which you had end of the day. So you have to account for this. And the easiest thing to do it is that you just get rid of such samples where you know that there was an out of stock situation. So out of stock situation is easy. End of the day, you have stock zero. And then what is a bit more difficult is if you would have zero just beginning of the day, then it's a full out of stock and you can just throw it away. If you go out of stock maybe 2 o'clock, so this might be that you had a huge sales this day because there was maybe some promotion which you didn't have the data for or something. So then you probably want to use this information, but then you have to come up with a bit more advanced approach. So for simplicity here, let's just say you remove the intraday out of stock situations, and then you are good actually with your training sample because you are not biased by out of stock anymore. Actually, if you would use them, such situations at 2 o'clock, your bias would go in the other direction. So then you would be biased above, actually. So, and the second thing is, it's not only out of stock. There might be also something like markdown sales. I don't know, probably not everybody of you knows what it is, but if you think of a yogurt or something which is due tomorrow, they sometimes go and have such a red thing on top of it, so a red sticker, and say, okay, so for today, it's half the price or something like this. And this, of course, is not true demand, what we want to predict, but because in the end, as a supermarket, you don't want to buy this stuff by less. So you want to buy it as long as it's fresh and it's full price. So that means the demand you want to predict is not the markdown demand. So this is kind of only a fractional demand what you have there. So that means you have to learn somehow how much demand is markdown worth. So, and this you can do with all kinds of methods. So in the end, you just learn a weight factor and say, okay, so I only weight my markdown demand by some factor, and then I come up with the true demand in the end. So that means this is to get our target, which is not the true sales. Okay, so now it's a lot of text. So I will go over the different steps on examples, only to give you an overview how we would do it. So we use a kind of an in-house developed machine learning algorithm, but it's not too important here that you understand the inner workings of it. You could basically use every machine learning algorithm. You could use gradient boosting or whatever. So we use this one because it's really fitting quite nice to the use cases in retail and because of some of the inner workings I will show you later on a bit. But for here, it's not too important that it's something special. So you could just think of it as a random forest gradient boosting. Okay, and this we use to estimate the mean demand, so just a number. So that means tomorrow, our probability density function will have a mean of about 5.2 or something like this. So this we use with such a machine learning model, which I showed you on the slides before, with all the different inputs you have there. So that means product location information, so the finest level. You have group information, kind of hierarchy. You have seasonalities, promotions, prices, holidays, everything. So you put all this in your model. In the end, you get a mean prediction. And this is a horizon-less model. So that means what I mean with horizon is to how many days in the future I'm predicting. I'm predicting the demand for a day. So let's say in 2 days, so then my forecast horizon would be 2. So because I have a lag of 2, I have information until today and want to predict 2 days in the future. But I could also predict, let's say, 2 weeks in the future, for example. If I already know what the prices will be, the only information I don't have is the sales. So that means from a time series perspective, I can only use sales with a lag of the prediction horizon. But my machine learning model, if I would not include time series information in first place, could just predict as long in the future as I have the information about the core inputs, like prices, for example. So usually this is not too long in the future because all these retailers don't know their prices too long in advance. So some of them plan their promotions for the whole year, but most of them just say, okay, in the next 2 weeks the prices are like this, and they might change. So that means your prediction might also change over time if they change these. Yeah.
How do you tackle holidays or some traditional events where people are going to buy next day some stuff that they usually do year by year, or maybe not so regular, but well known to the public?
I will come to events on the next slide, so this will probably answer your question. So go over the details there. Just let me let me say some words about this horizon thing because it's also interesting to understand. So on top of this, we do a weather model. And for a weather model, the horizon information because you have to deal with weather forecasts rather than with actual weather. So this is the first thing. So that means, let's say for a prediction in 5 days, you use the weather forecast in five days. And also in the past, you use the weather forecast with a lag of 5 as your input feature. If you would use the actuals, you would overfit. So that means you would underestimate the variance of your problem because you would have more or less used future information in the past. Even if the forecasts are very good, they have some larger variance than you would have in the actuals. So that means you cannot do this. And this is then a kind of an update of our first machine learning model on a horizon-dependent base. It's only update here because we want to train this one actually a horizon less, and then we train this one on top. So for performance reasons and everything else. So and then on top of this, we kind of do a residual correction for the time series of the sales. So that means we had now a model which would not account for recent sales, for example, because we just have the target for the last years. Maybe we have learned some trends and stuff, but anyway, you would not account for recent changes in sales, which you probably don't have in your, you don't have information in your features why the sales went up. So it might be just some weird reason which I don't know. You anyway can account for it if you just correct for the residuals of the sales and the demands over the last days. So this is not always perfect, but in some cases it's useful. And you will see later on that actually this does not much if you have a good model in first place. So that means this is only a kind of a rescue in case where your model is really wrong. And now I said I have a mean prediction. Until here, and now I want the probability density in the end. So there are different ways how you could deal with it. You could learn an empiric density or whatever, if you have a non-parametric method or whatever you want, if you don't know how it will look like. If you know how it will look like, so in this case, it will, as I showed earlier, it will more or less follow a Poisson gamma or a negative binomial distribution. And if you know this, then you can take a parametric model and just learn the second parameter of it. And in this case, it is the variance. So if you know the mean and the variance, you know how this such a density would look like, and you already have it. And to get the mean, for example, an easy trick would be to learn the absolute deviation. So a second machine learning model, same thing as this one, but not with the target demand, but with the target absolute deviation of demand from sales, for example. So of your in-sample demand or out-of-sample demand, how you would do it, it's up to you, how advanced you would do it. In this case, you can use in-sample, actually. And then if you have those two, you can calculate the variance from the absolute deviation by kind of an iterative approach. So easiest thing would be Newton, for example. And in the end, you would come up with a mean and a variance, and you have your distribution. So this is now kind of the introduction, and now we'll come to the examples. And actually, the first one is to your question, so about events. So I cannot read it that good, right? Okay, but anyway, it's not too important. So you have here a time series over, this is now about a year or something, so where the yellow lines correspond to the actual sales. So it's not demand, it's sales. And the blue line correspond to the prediction, which we did with such a model. So so there are actually two blue lines. One is dashed and one is solid. So the solid one is the one from our machine learning model in first place, so including weather and stuff. And the second one is the one with the residual correction. So that means if you just take into account recent sales. And they are not very different, and this is usually what you want. Because if you think of something like you would miss such an event where you have such a peaking structure, if you would just account for the recent sales, what would happen usually in a time series model? You would set the second peak right after it, and this would be maximum wrong, I would say, what you could do. So usually you don't want to have such a situation. So and now how we learn this. So here you could see it's just three different holidays. You cannot read it, but it doesn't matter too much. It's American holidays in this case. Which affect some of the products, but not all of them. They might affect some of the locations, but not all of them. In this case, what you could see here in this visualization is just a product group. So that means I just aggregated up all the different products in a product group. So think of it, for example, as vegetables as a product group. with 100 different products or something. And we just show the sum of the mean predictions and the sum of the sales. So you can sum up the means. You could not just easily sum up the densities, but here we're only looking at the means. And you could see, okay, all the different products might have a similar structure, but this is it's much more volatile there, of course. But here you could see really nice things. So actually, you also see the sales a year ago in red. You can't read it too good. But usually what you would do is you would look back the last few years, for example. So let's say the last three Christmas for this product in this location, how did the sales behave? And then you could learn, okay, maybe 14 days before Christmas, the sales starts to rise, something like this. And this would be a feature which you would have in your model, just days to an event or something. And then it starts to get a bit subtle because you might have lots of events. So it might not only be holidays, it can be anything, which is just location specific. And many of them are only fluctuations. So that means you only have a few true effects which hold over years and which you could use for predicting. And of course, you want to get rid of all the fluctuations. So that means you have to have some kind of regularization here. And usually what you do is you look to all your events, look at some days around the events, look if you have a significant increase or decrease or somehow change in sales due to that. And then you have to do some kind of regularization. So for example, a lasso approach or something, so that they would say, okay, if it's not significant, I just set it to zero and I just throw away the event. So that means you do kind of a feature selection where you say, okay, I only use those events which have a significant impact on sales. And this you would do then on different levels. So it, as I said, so the prediction in the end would be on item store level. But beforehand, you can look at it in the model on different levels. So you could look at, for example, at such a group level and look how a group would behave to a specific event. And here's something about seasonality, those two. So this is now at a discounter. So in maybe some region where the payday has a quite large effect. So this is actually always beginning of the month. So beginning of the month, you see that the sales is suddenly rising. And okay, this is something which is not too difficult to learn. If you just go to the location, look at this information, and such a machine learning model would easily learn that you have a rise at the beginning of each month. So this you could also do with a time series analysis, of course. For events, it would be a bit more difficult. There you would have to use exogenous features to have this in, for example. So seasonality is another time series thing. So this is now just an item store combination. Cannot read it, but it is. And over a year, so you see this this item in this store is rising in summer, and it's somehow lower in winter and spring. So these are just real world seasonality examples. And of course, you have a weekly structure. So this you see here everywhere. So these are actually weekly structures. This lower peaks, and this is then the event on top of it. So you have to deal with all these things. So on Saturday, for example, here the red dot means Saturday is the sales is usually largest. And this can be different for different products. So not all products have to have the peak on Saturday. Might be another product which has it on Wednesday. So usually it is kind of a hierarchy that you say, okay, all products in a specific group are having the peak on a Saturday. So that means you want to use the hierarchy at some point. But in the end, you also have to account for cases where it's not like this. And not all products might have this seasonality. So there might be products which have their peak in winter, for example. So that means you have to account for it on the lowest level, actually. So now I come to a bit more complicated thing, and this is, for example, price. So this is now not price setting, so not in the sense of a causal model. It is a causal effect, but we are not setting the price here. We're just accounting for it in our prediction model. So here we see the demand price elasticity. So this usually means you have a lower price for an item and then the demand gets higher. So, and this is what you see here. So this is really unfortunate that you cannot see it, but this means here the price is quite high always when you have the dip, the price is high, and you, when you have the peaks here, the price is low. So and this is a product where this is changing pretty frequently. So we have only a few months of data here, and you see, okay, you have again, you have a weekly structure, and you have all the other effects on top of it. But the main effect for this peaking structure is actually the price, because it's changing here. And this, of course, you have to account for. So if you have a retailer which just has some price strategy, and you know about it for a few weeks, then you can just use it and predict the demand according to the price. And you can directly tell them, okay, if you set the price higher, then here your demand will be lower. And this is, of course, very important information. But there can also be such huge effects, for example. Here would be an effect of a promotion which just shoots up the demand by a huge factor. This can also happen. So something which is usually not sold at all, more or less, if you are not in promotion. So the red things here mean that it's in promotion. And it's not always in each and every promotion that it has the same effect. So there might be different promotions. There might be TV ads. There might be leaflets or something like this. So, and this might be a case where you really have a huge factor going up. But how could the model learn something like this? So the easy answer is somewhere in the past they had a similar promotion which looked like this, and the model just learned it. So it might be in another product even. So the model has learned it on a product group level, but it might also be on the same product, and it just knew from the past that it would go like, up like this. And this is not it's not done by the time series here. So it's really done by the first place machine learning model. Now weather is the same thing. So weather effects, you have the same situation. So you can think of weather effects usually as a kind of event-like structure on top of seasonality. So it's easy to predict that that ice cream will be sold more in summer than in winter. So this is just an easy seasonal effect. But what is more difficult is that ice cream will be sold quite heavily next Saturday, because this will be the first hot day this year or something like this. And this is then such an event-like structure where you say, for example, here. So this was, you see in the thin blue thing is just the weather. So that means the weather was quite stable over this time, so the temperature in this case. And here there was a sudden temperature rise, and here was also a sudden temperature rise. And this sudden temperature rise leads to a sudden increase in sales, for example. And this is something which you have to learn again from the past. So you know, in the past few years, there were such sudden sales weather drops or weather increases in summer or in winter, and then the sales follows it, and you just learn it again by machine learning and can predict it for the future. And as I said, so the difficult thing here is that you are not dealing with absolute effects, but with rather with relative effects. So temperature drops in winter, for example, if you think on stuff like winter motoring or something like this, or sudden rises in summer, if you think of ice cream. Yeah.
How much do you have to intentionally build your model to try and factor in those kinds of decisions, and how much does that naturally fall out and you observe post facto?
Okay, so the question is about feature engineering, and this is usually what we do here. So it's kind of the opposite to the deep learning approach, I would say. So I would only give the raw features. So I would say with this problem here, you will have a pretty hard time to come up with a general model which would just learn from the raw features the full picture. So I tried, actually, and didn't come up with a deep learning model which could learn these things as good. So maybe you can in future, but at the moment I would doubt that you can do this without feature engineering. Okay, so even because this is more difficult actually than what I explained. So it's not only that it's a temperature rise, it's something like the first hot weekend or something like this. So not every temperature rise is the same. So the model really has a hard time to learn these effects without domain knowledge. Okay, this is my last example. This is what I said earlier. This is an interesting one. Cannibalization, or the different effect, is called halo effect. So this is interesting. So do you have one product which just goes in promotion sometimes, and when it goes to promotion, the sales is increasing quite heavily. And then you have a similar product. So maybe this is some kind of strawberry yogurt or something, and this might be a cherry yogurt or something like this, whatever, or just anything. And you have to find out such pairs or such group of products which behave together. And then you could see for this one. So this usually the sales is quite stable. But if the other one goes to promotion, we have a dip in sales here. And yeah, it can be the other way around. So one thing goes to promotion and you can have another products which go up in sales. Or even you do what the discounters sometimes do, you do a promotion for some special product or something, and then your sales in your whole store goes up because the people go there on this day and do their shopping for the whole week or something like this. So, and these effects also, these are quite difficult to learn without putting in external knowledge or an external model. Here you could just go ahead and use, for example, again, an approach which would avoid overfitting or something and throw away non-significant effects, and could use each and every pair of products, for example, in a product group, and could search for such things. And in the end, you would just give the model the information that you have now found a pair which behaves together, and then you could use it in the machine learning as feature. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's the question was how you would find such pairs. So it's again the same. So you would look to the past. You know that that one product was in promotion. So you would look at such a cannibalizing product which goes to promotion and think of it as a kind of a significance matrix, where we would look at the sales of another product, so just the sales of the two products. Look if the sales of one product goes up, if there is a correlation to the sales of another product, so only in case if it's in promotion. And you do this over the whole past for all the different products, and in the end you will come up with kind of a heat map where you would see which products are influencing which others. And then you would just include this information in the model. It's always the same, always learning from the past, what we have here. That also means if you don't have seen such a structure in the past and it's a new thing, of course you cannot predict it. So that's okay, so now a bit about the algorithm we are using here and a few words about explainability. So up to now, I only talked about accuracy of the model, but what is also important for in business decisions, usually at least, is explainability, because the customers sometimes want to know why the prediction is as it is. And if I say why the prediction is as it is, I usually don't mean the feature importance in our training step. Of course, this is also very interesting and you want to know it. The customer sometimes want to know about it, but in the end, what the customer is interested in is, we have now one day before Christmas, and there is this specific item which in this store has an order which is amount of 10 higher than they would have expected. And they then come to us and ask us, okay, so why is this the case? I want to understand why your demand is going up by such a huge effect. And then it's good if you have a model which can really explain a specific prediction why it is as it is. And here we have a model which has, this is a bit simplistic here, but you have kind of a multiplicative approach where you could say, okay, I have now different features. So for simplicity, I only have 5 features here. So this is one sample, so one observation, one day, one store, one item. And you have just factors for each and every feature. So that means if a feature has no effect, you have a factor of 1. We have 1 normalization, of course, which is just your global mean. And then you have the other features, which might have a factor of 0.7 in this case, which might have a factor sometimes of 10, if this is a really huge effect or something like this. And then if you have this on really an individualized level, so for each and every predictions of this millions and of predictions you have every day, you could look into this and could say to the customer, okay, look, in the end, it was this factor of our features which was driving your prediction. Maybe it was just a hot day predicted or something. Hot day predicted at Christmas and the ice cream goes up. Okay, this will not happen, but it could. But yeah, and this is kind of explanation on individual predictions, and this is something which is quite important in such business things, that you also can give some reasoning behind your decisions. And so there are packages which can do this for each and every black box method. For example, Lime is such a package where I could just try to explain your predictions later on locally. Here it is just an intrinsic thing of the model, and I will show on the next slides a bit how it works. So this now starts to get a bit complicated, I guess, but this is how the model in the inner workings of the model would do. So how we can do such a local prediction and how we can come to the accuracy and everything. So I've just now three examples here for simple features. So this is now just weekday, the item number and the store number. Can also be, doesn't have to be store number, it can also be descriptive features of stores. This might be even better than you could generalize for a new store, for example. But if you're just learning from the past for the same store, you can just go ahead and use the store number. Okay, so now you, here you could see what the model has learned. So that means we have two stores in this training. Only two stores. One of the store has a factor of 0.9, for example. The other one has a factor of 1.2. So that means you have in first place, your easiest, highest hierarchy of the model would be global mean of the sales for everything. Then you would have something like the factor for the different stores. One store has a higher sales level than the other store. Easy thing, have just learned such a factor, and then you have the store level. Then you go up all the different product hierarchies, for example, and in the end you come up to the item number. So that means each and every item has a different sales level. Bananas are sold much more often than some fashion thing or something like this. And by doing this, you you have just different factors. They factor up, and in the end you come to a prediction of one single item store combination. And for weekdays, for example, you want to learn, for example, in the beginning, the global structure. So that means for every product in the supermarket chain, I want to know how the weekday distribution is. And here you would have a factor in the end for Friday and Saturday, which is higher than for the beginning of the week, for example. And this is what I said earlier, this might change on the different level of granularity. And you take into account all these different things, do correlations, really a multivariate approach, and in the end you come up with the prediction. And what is interesting here now is that what we use is that we have an optimization in each and every bin of these things. So that means we learn the deviations between the actual sales and our predictions in sample in each and every bin here. So that means you can really learn rare effects. It doesn't only have to be products, it can also be for events. So you say, okay, so you learn this for a special event, which is only maybe two times in your history of your data set. Usually it would be regularized away by a usual linear model. And here you kind of use a local method where you would take into account also such small effects with one factor. And if you do something like this, you are usually heavily overfitting. So that means you have to have regularization in place afterwards to get rid of the overfitting. And this can be as easy as you just take only fit a linear line to these different factors in the different bins. In this case, it makes no sense because item number is not ordered. But if you think, for example, of a weekday, or if you later on think for customer-specific stuff, for example, age or something, there you could just regularize with splines or with orthogonal polynomials or whatever. And this is very important, of course, so such a smoothing of these methods afterwards. And what is nice here is that how we do the modeling in the end, so this is exactly to the question we had earlier. So we usually come up with such a model, and then we see, for example, in some of these bins, for some of the items, we have deviations between our predictions and the truths, so in-sample deviations. And this is then just bias, so something the model has not learned yet. So that means you know, okay, you have to build something special, either on the algorithmic side or just feature engineering, for this group of observations, because these you don't have a good explanation yet. And yeah, this helps a lot if you have a method like this, because here you are dealing really with a large number of different items. It's a very difficult problem because each and every item can have a completely different structure in time series, for example. Okay, and now you even want to have something like more complex correlations in here. So this is now, 5 minutes? Okay, so then I skipped the 2D correlations because they are anyway a bit complicated to explain. Only thing here is interesting is that if you think, for example, of decision trees or something like this, then or gradient boosting, you would take decision trees with maybe, for example, a decision tree with 5 different nodes or 5 different features in. This would be kind of a 5D correlation. And in here, you could explicitly build something like 2D, 3D combinations where I think, okay, in this case, day of year, so seasonality on item level is something which I want to learn the deviations even more explicit than the global correlation. And for building something like this, so this is an extreme case of feature engineering, actually. But you usually use it for such cases. Okay, so now some words to the actual decision step in the end. So I said we have now this probability density function for each item. And so what I know then is if I follow this thing and I just order the mean, I'm somewhere in between here. So if I go to one of the high or the low percentiles, I know that maybe I will generate waste or I will come up with lost sales. But this doesn't have to be bad, so it depends in the end on the costs of the customer. So it's really kind of a risk management which you can do with something like this. So that means if you think of in terms of the two costs here, so you have an out-of-stock rate and you have an excess stock, so that means waste. And if you go for a low quantile, that means you likely sell everything, you might run out of stock. If you go for a high quantile instead, you might come up with waste. So this is actually the situation you are dealing with. And you now have the chance to decide what you want. So that means you have this curve. So this is your probability density function. And you can just, as customer, decide where on the curve you want to be. This might be the mean. This might be 2 different quantiles. So it's your choice. And what would happen if you have a better demand forecasting model? Just means that your curve would be lower here. So that means your numbers get better, the choice stay the same in the end. And if you know your costs, so if the customer really knows its cost, and the cost might be here ordering in cases, if you order too much, you have waste costs. If you order too few, you have lost sales costs. And this might be multidimensional. It doesn't have to be only these two costs. It can be many others. And then what you do in the end is just an optimization, so a minimization in a high-dimensional place in this case. And you use it. You use just your density function you have learned before to do it. And I will skip this one. So this is just a summary of the different things. And in the end, this is such an automation effect which you have here. So that means we started with an out of stock of 7.5% in mean in some supermarket chain, and then this would be we started to introduce the automation in some of the stores, so the machine learning, so it goes up slightly, and this would then be the drop where it was just in place in all different stores. And this is not only because our prediction quality is that good. The major effect here is actually automation, because beforehand it was just gut feeling and a lot of it was just wrong what the people did, because it's not possible to do it for all different products. And this is an effect which you usually see there if you use machine learning in such business problem. It's really a huge effect if you go from gut feeling decisions to really statistical powered decisions. So unfortunately, I have to skip the customer targeting, which is very interesting, but we have no time for it. So, and go directly to the final words. So this I already said. So for decision making, when you would use machine learning or artificial intelligence, usually always when you are dealing with uncertainties, because humans are very bad when making decisions with uncertainty. So this is something which we just not good in. And if you have many influencing factors, okay, this is clear, because in your head you cannot take into account each and every effect. So you maybe only take into account the 2 major effects. And in the end, everywhere where you where there is need for automation, because probably you don't want to have somebody who is doing millions of ordering or pricing decisions every day for a store. So yeah, so these are usually the cases where you would go in business decisions with machine learning. Okay, so that being said, so I'm from Blue Yonder, and so just recently we got acquired by JDA. So we have now a bit more financial power behind us. So that means we are hiring again. So. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We have 5 minutes for questions. So if you have questions.
You can ask about targeting if you want.
Thanks for the talk. Do you have mechanisms in place to deal with cases where actually the gut feeling, or not the gut feeling, but there is informed information on the side of the customer? For example, they know that they have not done any promotion like this in the past, so the model cannot have learned it, but now they're doing it and they want to adjust it or something like this. So how do you deal with that?
Okay. Something like this happens, of course. So sometimes the customer knows better. So there might be such situations because, I mean, they have a lot of domain knowledge and they know their business usually. So that might be, if you think, for example, on special discounts around Christmas, which they haven't done before. So the model would not be able to learn it from the past. So then they would come up with kind of a prediction, which they think is more accurate than ours. And usually what we are doing then in production is that our system does the prediction. So the customer gets it, and the customer has the chance to do something like priority predictions. So they would just say, okay, so I want to override the whole prediction group by a factor of 2 or something like this, because I think that it will just jump up because of this special promotion. And this is something which we allow. So sometimes it's useful. It's definitely not useful to do it all the time for all products, because then you are losing again the power. But sometimes it is important. And this comes with the explainability, for example. It's important for the customers to steer the stuff a bit, and it's important to understand it. And in the end, the cost function is the same thing, right? So the customer has to decide which costs are important. So the customer always plays a big role there, yeah.
Hi, thanks for the talk. Can you touch on customer targeting conceptually? For example, I'm curious if you used collaborative filtering. And in terms of the data collection, I'm curious if you had to have your customers be members with a program or something like that.
Okay, very shortly then, customer targeting, how you would do it. So that means you just, for example, think of it, you send a coupon to a customer or you won't send it. You have some policy in the past and you want to get rid of it, so either by random selection, A-B testing, or by something like propensity score reweighting. So this, I just say you know it now. And how you would do something like this, so that means a simple approach would be with machine learning. You just go ahead and have a target, like, for example, the gross margin you generate by each customer. You do a training where you include this information if it's in group A, where everybody gets the coupon, group B, where nobody gets it. And in the end, you do a prediction with the feature set to one or the other, and your difference would be the prediction for the causal effect. So this is the easy approach. And what we usually do is we do kind of a statistical background subtraction there. So that means in the end, you want to have a targeting decision where you only contact customers which have an individual positive effect. And to get this individual positive effect, you kind of use a statistical background subtraction to learn the small causal effect on top of a large, maybe uninteresting effect. So this is kind of, so the basics behind it go back to the two calculus, but you could think of it kind of a Rubin causality-like thing, which we do here with the A-B testing and with sideband subtraction in the end to learn the causal effect. So this is the very short story. Nobody could understand it in this time, I know. Yeah, it's a customer identifier. Yeah. So that means, for example, the sales history of this specific customer, for example, the age, the gender, whatever. So this you have in your machine learning approach. As feature. An ID, for example, yes. Yeah. You have a customer ID for everyone. So if you want to do it customized, you have to have something like an ID. If you want, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, you can ask me also in the coffee break if there are more questions. So
thank you. Thank you, Felix.
I think there was a switch here. Okay.